Dear friends, I am pleased to be here with you today. My name is Eva Kaur. I am a survivor of Auschwitz, a survivor of Mengele's medical experiment in Auschwitz, and now I am trying to survive old age. How I survived Auschwitz is my story of a promise kept. 70 years ago, I made a pledge, a promise to myself that I would survive Auschwitz together with my twin sister Miriam. My family was deported directly to Auschwitz on a Hungarian transport from Transylvania, Romania, which was occupied by the Hungarian army. In my family was my father, Alexander, age 44, my mother, Jaffa, age 38, my older sister, Edith, age 14, my middle sister, Alice, age 12, and my twin sister, Miriam, and I, age 10. We had been traveling for 4 days in an extremely crowded condition when our cattle car came to a sudden stop. As soon as we stepped down from the cattle car, my mother grabbed my twin sister and me by the hand. We were her youngest children, and she hoped that as long as she could hold on to us, that somehow she could protect us. I will never forget that little strip of land called the selection platform, measuring 85 by 35 feet. There is no other strip of land like that anywhere on the face of this earth, where millions of people being ripped apart from their families forever. We had been standing on the selection platform for about 10 minutes, and in my childish curiosity, I looked around, trying to figure out what this place was, when I realized that my father and two older sisters had disappeared in the crowd. I never saw them again. We were holding on to mother as a Nazi was running and yelling in German, "Twins, twins." We did not volunteer any information. The SS noticed us because we were dressed alike and we looked alike. He asked my mother if we were twins. She replied, "Is that good?" When the Nazi said yes, my mother said yes. And at that moment, another Nazi came, pulled my mother in one direction, us in the opposite direction. We were crying, she was crying. All I remember is seeing my mother's arms stretched out in despair as she was pulled away. I never even got to say goodbye to her. Miriam and I were left crying and holding hands. We no longer had a family. We were all alone. We became part of a group of little girls, all twins. Our group was taken to a huge processing center. Our clothes were taken away, and we sat naked on long benches for most of the day. It was late in the afternoon when our processing began. We were given short haircuts. Our dresses were returned with a huge oil-painted red cross on the back. Then they lined us up for registration and tattooing. When my turn came, I decided to give them as much trouble as a 10-year-old could. Four people restrained me while they heated a pen-like gadget with a needle. The needle was heated over the flame of a lamp, and when it got hot, they dipped it into ink, and then they burned into my left arm. Dot by dot, the capital letter A, dash, 7063. My twin sister Miriam, when I compared notes with Miriam, she told me that in addition to creating a general confusion I beat the Nazi holding my arm. I am sure that I was capable of it, but I don't remember biting anyone. I was raised to be a nice girl, and as we know, nice girls don't bite. So I must have blocked it out of my mind. Auschwitz was the only Nazi camp that tattooed its inmates. My husband, Michael, who is a four-year survivor of Buchenwald, does not have a tattoo. Once we were processed, we were marched throughout the camp and taken to a barrack that was a wooden modular horse barn, filthy and crude. It was divided in two by a brick bench with a walkway on each side and three-story high bunk beds. Our bunk bed was on the bottom, and since we hadn't slept in 4 days, we tried to get some sleep. But human beings cannot function after such a traumatic day. I couldn't sleep, and I kept tossing and turning. And as I was tossing and turning, I noticed something big and dark shapes moving on the floor. I counted them, and when I got to 5, I jumped up screaming, "Mice! Mice!" But these were very big mice. A girl from the top bunk bed said, "Silly kid, these are not mice. They are rats, and they are everywhere." Now we really couldn't sleep, so we went to the latrine. There on the filthy latrine floor were the scattered corpses of 3 children. I had never ever seen anyone dead before, but to me it was clear that it could happen to us unless I did something to prevent it. So right then and there, I made a silent pledge, a promise to myself that I would do anything and everything within my power to make sure that Miriam and I would not end up on that filthy latrine floor, that somehow we would survive and walk out of this camp alive. After leaving the latrine, I put an image of Miriam and me walking out of this camp alive, hand in hand, and I never let go of that image until we were liberated. During our time in Auschwitz, we were reduced to the lowest form of human existence. We were starved for food, starved for human kindness, and starved for the love of the mothers and fathers we once had. We had no rights, but we had a fierce determination to live one more day, survive one more experiment. We were used in a variety of inhuman medical experiments, including deadly injections. After one of those injections, I became very ill with a very high fever. I was taken to the hospital, hovering between life and death. I remember my promise, and I did everything in my power to live one more day. After 2 weeks, my fever broke and I felt a lot better and stronger. It took another 3 weeks before my fever chart showed normal, and I was released from the barrack of the living dead and reunited with Miriam at the twins' barrack. At the end of August of 1944, an airplane appeared over the skies of Auschwitz. It was flying low, and I could see the American flag on a wing. That gave me the hope that somebody was trying to free us, and hope in Auschwitz was in very short supply. The air raids continued and increased, and by the end of November, it felt like a battlefield. We would feel in every ounce of our being that this could not last much longer, and that one day soon we would be free and go home. It was early January when the Nazis told us, everybody out of the barracks, we are taking you deep into Germany to protect you from the fighting. I decided that I didn't like the Nazis when they were winning the war. So they are probably going to be even meaner now that they are losing the war. So we stayed in our barrack. We woke up to empty guard towers and no Nazis. There were about 8,500 inmates who did not go on that death march. We realized that we needed to get blankets, water, and bread. We called it organizing, which meant actually stealing from the Nazis. On January 18, 1945, four Nazis returned to Birkenau to blow up the crematorium, the gas chamber, and try to eliminate the evidence. Our barrack was set on fire, and when we ran outside, the same four Nazis were waiting for us, ordering us to march. If you did not march fast enough, you were shot on the spot. We were taken to Auschwitz I and ran into the barracks for safety. On January 27, 1945, at 4:30 p.m., Saturday afternoon, a woman ran into the barrack yelling at the top of her voice, "We are free! We are free!" I looked out the window, seeing nothing. I went downstairs to check out the rumor. It was snowing heavily. I stood there 30 minutes, but finally I could see people wrapped in white camouflage raincoats, smiling from ear to ear. And the most important part was they didn't look like the Nazis. They gave us chocolate, cookies, and hugs. This was my first taste of freedom, for me to realize that Miriam and I were alive, that my little promise to myself that first night in the latrine, that Miriam and I would survive and walk out of this camp alive, became a reality. I kept my promise. We survived. We returned. I have learned many important lessons through my tragic life, and I want to share with you one lesson about forgiveness. I forgave the Nazis. I forgave everybody. If anyone would have asked me in 1993 if I was going to forgive the Nazis, I would have said, find a good psychiatrist, because you must be crazy. I was a very good victim. I was angry with the world. I hated everybody, and I yelled a lot. Nothing really happened to change that until Miriam died on June 6, 1993, from a rare form of cancer that the doctors believed was a result of the experiment. When I came home that day, there was a message on my answering machine telling me that Miriam had died. I had a desperate need to say goodbye to her, but they would not wait for me. The funeral would be within 10 hours, and there was no way for me to get there. I was left with a lot of pain, waking up many nights, unable to breathe, realizing that Miriam's lungs were filled with cancer. I knew that I had to do something in her memory. That is how I coped with pain. 2 years later, I opened Kendall's Holocaust Museum in Terre Haute, Indiana. 1 month after Miriam died, I received a telephone call from a professor at Boston College. He asked me to come and lecture to doctors at a conference in Boston. I told him I love to lecture to doctors because when I go to see the doctor, they tell me that I am too fat, I don't exercise enough, and then after then I have to pay them. So I would like to tell the good doctors what they do wrong. And after I chew them out, I look forward to them paying me. This is my way of getting even with all the doctors in the world. He said, when you come to Boston, can you bring with you a Nazi doctor? I was stunned and said, where on earth do you think I can find one of those guys? Last time I looked in the yellow pages, they are not advertising there. He asked me to think about it and maybe I come up with some idea. And I remember the documentary that Miriam and I worked on together in 1992 with a German television. It had a Nazi doctor in it by the name of Hans Munch. I faxed a letter to Germany asking for his phone number in the memory of Miriam, and they gave it to me. Dr. Munch was not willing to come to Boston, but he was willing to meet with me in Germany. My nightmares stopped, but my problem was that I was scared to death about meeting a Nazi doctor. For days, I could not sleep. I couldn't close my eyes. Every cell in my body was rebelling against my actions. I wondered what could I learn from our experiments, if Dr. Munch knew anything about it. I was curious, why was he willing to meet with me? We arrived in Germany at his house, and he treated me with the utmost respect, but he knew nothing about our experiments because Mengele always said to him that our experiments were top secret. He did give me a good interview, and then I heard myself say to him, do you know anything about the gas chambers in Auschwitz? He told me this was a nightmare he lived with every single day of his life and went on describing the operation of the gas chamber. I never knew that the gas chambers operated that way, and I told him so. And this was very important information, and I asked if he was willing to come to Auschwitz and sign a document describing his first-hand account at the ruins of the gas chamber, so that if I ever met a revisionist or deniers, I could shove this paper in their face. He immediately said that he would love to. I came home excited that I would have a historic document and wanted to thank this Nazi doctor. But how do you do that? I did not know where I could look for a gift for a Nazi doctor. So I went to the local Hallmark shop looking for a thank you card, a thank you selection for a card. I read cards for 2.5 hours with no luck. I left, but I could not give up on finding him a meaningful gift. For the next 10 months, I kept asking myself, how could I thank him? What could I give him? Then one simple idea came to me. I was going to write and give Dr. Munch a letter of forgiveness. I knew this would be a meaningful gift for him, but I realized it was a life-changing event for me. I discovered that I had the power to forgive. No one could give me that power, and no one could take it away. I began writing my letter of forgiveness. It took me 4 months to work through all the pain. As my former English professor was correcting my spelling, she said, it's nice that you are forgiving Dr. Munch, but your problem is really with Dr. Mengele. When you go home tonight, pretend you are talking to Dr. Mengele and forgiving him. See how it makes you feel. I tried it, and I was surprised that I could do it, and even more surprised that it made me feel good. I could do something, and he could not stop me. I decided if I forgave Mengele, I would forgive all the people who had ever hurt me. On January 27, 1995, we were in Auschwitz. Dr. Munch signed his document, and I signed mine. I immediately felt that all the pain I carried for 50 years lifted from my shoulder. I was no longer a victim of Auschwitz, nor was I a prisoner of my tragic past. I was free of Auschwitz and free of Mengele. So my lesson is, forgive your worst enemy. Forgive everybody who has ever hurt you. Forgiveness is an act of self-healing, self-liberation, and self-empowerment. It will heal your soul, and it will set you free. Not only did I keep my promise to survive, I now survive without anger and pain, and I am able to enjoy life. I can even dance if I want to. What happened in Auschwitz did not prevent me from being the person who I want to be. Congratulations, you survived my lecture, and I survived my lecture. And if any of you want to talk to me or take pictures, you can meet me at Kendall's booth. Thank you. I can only add to that this is the first time in 3 years that I am sick. But I made a promise, and I kept my promise.